histology of the digestive system, and particularly about structure of the pharynx, esophagus, and stomach. Let me start from the general plan of the structure of digestive system. Let me remind you, digestive system is composed by two large groups of organs, tubular organs, first group, and parenchymal organs. Parenchymal organs, there are digestive glands. We will tell about them later, next lecture. And today, let's start from the group of tubular organs. Tubular organs create large group, which is named digestive tube. All of organs have tubular organs have tubular shape, space inside, and three layers of the wall. Here you can see general plan of structure of these layers. Inner layer, the mucosa. Middle layer, it's a muscularis, and the outer layer, it's serosa or adventitia. What about submucosa? Sometimes you can meet information in some books that different book that in the wall of tubular organs, digestive tube, present four layers. If we are talking about submucosa, if we explain submucosa as an isolated layer. If submucosa, you mean that submucosa is a part of mucosa, so you can tell about presence of three layers, both variant possible. So mucosa together with submucosa, muscularis and serosa, three layers, or mucosa, submucosa, muscularis, and fourth layer is a serosa. Mucosa is introduction. Yes, mucosa. Mucosa is not simple structure, it's a compound structure because it's made up of some laminas. It's not only one layer of structures, it's three layers. The upper lamina is epithelium, next one lamina propria. And last one, muscularis mucosa. If you remember here present muscularis like a middle layer of the wall of the digestive tube. But mucosa has it all muscularis layers, always composed by smooth muscle tissue. So let's come back to the structure of mucosa. Epithelium in different places of the digestive tube can be of different types. In the oral cavity, it's a stratified squamous, keratinized or non-keratinized. In the pharynx, in the upper sort and middle sort of the esophagus, it's a stratified squamous, non-keratinized. In the lower portion of the esophagus, the epithelium from the stratified squamous, non-keratinized, change to the simple columnal epithelium, and in the stomach it's a simple columnal epithelium in the same type epithelium in the small and large intestine till finish part of the rectum. In the rectum we have changed back to the simple stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. So finally we have stratified squamous in the digestive tube. Talking about digestive tube, we have the same type epithelium in the oral cavity and in the finished part of the rectum. Why it happened? Because of similar origin, similar source of embryonic source of origin of the epithelium. Epithelium of the oral cavity and finished part ending part of the rectum origin from the ectoderm. And the middle part of the digestive tube epithelium origin from the endoderm. And what about lamina propria? Lamina propria is underlying connective tissue, which is a loose connective tissue. If you remember, loose connective tissue always contain blood vessels and lymphatic vessels and nervous network. And the main function of this Tissue, it's a trophic function for epithelium. Epithelium vascular tissue and get nutrition from underlying connective tissue from its blood vessels by draining through the basement membrane. So lamina propria. Sometimes lamina propria in different places of the digestive tube contains secretory portions of different glands. We will tell about it. Muscularis mucosae. Pay attention that muscularis mucosae present everywhere in the digestive tube except oral cavity. In the oral cavity, muscularis mucosae absent. The special ability, special properties of the mucosa of the oral cavity. Epithelium, we talked about epithelium. What is the meaning of the next layer means submucosa? If submucosa present, you can see it because it's a give movement ability for the mucosa. So mucosa can make different elements of relief. I mean folds, fova, like crypts. So in different places of the digestive tube, we have a different present of different type of elements of relief. For example, in the esophagus, we have mucosa create longitudinal folds. And in the stomach, we have different type of elements of relief, like foveola or gastric pits, and the folds or rugae, and the mammillary area. In the small intestine, they have deeply packed short folds, and like two large intestine, but we have tall and a lot of tall folds. Except folds, the mucosa of the small and large intestine have crypts, like evagination, deep evagination. It have other name in some places of the intestine. They can be named glands. And for example, in the small and large intestine, the direction of fold circular. Can you repeat? It was a question. In the small and large intestine, the direction of folds circular. In the finished part of the rectum, they have longitudinal folds. So in the esophagus and in the ending part of the rectum, the same direction of folds, longitudinal. In the middle part, circular. It's easier to remember. And it was about function of the submucosa. Submucosa except giving movement ability to the mucosa, it give trophic different trophic substances because it composed by loose connective tissue and contain large amount of blood capillaries, lymphatic capillaries, nervous network, sometimes present aggregation of lymphoid follicles. So in this part of the digestive tube where present aggregation of lymphoid follicles, this part of the digestive tube have extra function, immune function. And it sometimes contains secretory portions of glands. Here you can see different type, it's table of different type of epithelium in different organs of the digestive tube in the oral cavity. Stratified squamous, keratinized and non-keratinized both present. In the pharynx, non-keratinized, stratified, and the esophagus, non-keratinized, stratified, but you must remember about change of the non-keratinized, stratified epithelium in the lower part of the esophagus to the simple columna. In the stomach, simple colonal, in the small and large intestine, similar type, and in the anus, non-keratinized stratified squamous, like in the anterior part of the digestive tube. A lamina propria, we talked about lamina propria. It's about relief. We talked about relief. Except lungs, except Rubia, we have in the small intestine like extra type of element of relief. It's really they present only in the small intestine because of special function of the small intestine. Is it has absorptive function and really helpful for increasing absorptive surface of the small intestine. It increases absorptive surface of the small intestine. It's like projection of the lamina propria into epithelium. And the crypts, it's the opposite structure. It's invagination of the epithelium into the lamina propria. Depend on the structure, really, and the crypt, they are opposite because of structure. And muscularis mucosa. If you remember, muscularis mucosa absent in the oral cavity. In the other places of the digestive tube, muscularis mucosa present. It's composed by smooth muscle tissue. It's a two layers. It's a circular inner layer and outer longitudinal layer. And the mucosa, it's about elements of relief. We talked about it. Submucosa, yes, we talked about submucosa. And muscularis externa, it's a middle layer of the digestive tube. It can be composed by smooth muscle tissue or skeletal muscle tissue. In the muscularis externa, or muscularis, you can call it muscularis, made up of skeletal muscle tissue in the anterior part of the digestive tube. During embryonic development, we have formation of three parts of the digestive tube, yes, and the anterior and posterior part, has muscularis made up of skeletal muscle tissue, and the middle part made up of the smooth muscle tissue. So it's in the oral cavity, in the pharynx, in the esophagus, muscularis externa composed by skeletal muscle tissue. But pay attention that in the superior and middle third of the esophagus, we have skeletal muscle tissue. In the superior sort of the esophagus, it's a clear skeletal muscle tissue. In the second sort or middle sort of the esophagus, we have a present of mixed skeletal muscle tissue and smooth muscle tissue together. And in the lower part of the or inferior sort or third sort of the esophagus, we have clear smooth muscle tissue. It composed muscularis externa. So we have change in the lower part of the esophagus. We have changed skeletal muscle tissue to the smooth muscle tissue, which composed muscularis externa. So esophagus, it's very interesting and very hard organ. And the you must remember about in the lower part, we have change of the type of epithelium, type of muscle tissue, of the muscularis externa, and the next we have change of the external layer from the adventitia to serosa. And in the small and large intestine, muscularis externa made up of the smooth muscle tissue. It's composed by two layers of smooth muscle cells, longitudinal and circular layer, inner circular and the outer longitudinal. In the stomach, they have three layers. Only stomach has muscularis externa, which made up of three layers. It's a circular layer, it's a longitudinal layer, and here you can see oblique layer. In the large intestine, in the small intestine, outer longitudinal layer is complete. In the large intestine, outer longitudinal layer separated to three bands, which are named tenia. If you remember from the human anatomy, in the large intestine, they have present three tenia called tenia libera, tenia mesocolon, and tenia mentalis. At the places we are located, longitudinal smooth muscle cells, longitudinal bundles composed by longitudinal smooth muscle cells. So in the large intestine, outer longitudinal layer is separated, is not complete, unlike to the small intestine. And in the anus, in the lower part of the rectum, our muscularis externa, made up of the skeletal muscle tissue. So muscle tissue come back from the smooth muscle tissue to the skeletal. If you remember, sphincter ani externus, it's a skeletal muscle tissue. So we have changed smooth muscle tissue in the lower part of the rectum back to the skeletal. It's next circular is about, yes, it's about, and the outer layer. Outer layer of the digestive tube can be serosa, can be adventitia. In different places of the digestive tube, we can have different type of the outer layer. What differences at the first? What differences between adventitia and serosa? The basic part of the adventitia is a loose connective tissue, but the basic part of the serosa, it's a loose connective tissue too. But what differences? Serosa has extra component. It's covered by mesothelium. Mesothelium, it's like extra component, which present in the serosa and absent in the adventitia. Mesothelium, it's a simple squamous epithelium. Secretory epithelium, it can produce a little bit of serous fluid and release it to the space and can absorb it. And in different places of the human body, we have a different name of serosa. For example, in the thorax, it has special name, it's a pleura. And in the abdominal cavity, it has the other special name, it's a peritoneum. Yes, and the, around the heart, it has a name which is a pericardium. And the mesothelium everywhere produce a little bit of the fluid which release into the space, thin space between parietal and visceral layer of the serosa for lubrication of surface. It's helpful for peristaltic movement of different organs and spaces. So it's the differences between serosa and adventitia. So let's come back to anterior part of the digestive tube. In the pharynx, outer layer is adventitia. In the esophagus, in the superior and middle sort, it's adventitia. Outer layer, it's adventitia. It's made up of clear and made up of loose connective tissue. But in the lower part of the esophagus, we have change of adventitia to the serosa, particularly after penetration of the diaphragm. If you remember, esophagus go from the thorax to the abdomen and to the cardiac part of the stomach. And before entering, it penetrates the diaphragm. After penetration, it has change of the outer layer from the adventitia to the serosa, to the peritoneum. In the next part of the digestive tube, it's a stomach outer layer of the stomach. It's a serosa. And if you remember from the human anatomy, stomach is an intraperitoneal organ. It's covered by serosa from all sides. And next part is a small intestine. Small intestine outer layer, it's a serosa, but in some places which are mesoperitoneal, especially in the duodenum. Do you have particles in the duodenum which covered by adventitia? So this part of duodenum are mesoperitoneal parts. It's about large intestine, about large, talking about transverse coli and sigmoid. They are intraperitoneal, so the outer layers are serosa. Talking about ascending and descending part of the colon, you must remember that are mesoperitoneal, so some surfaces covered by serosa and other by adventitia. So it's a mix. Both type of outer layer can be present. And the rectum, outer layer of the rectum, it's the adventitia. Let's go to the pharynx. The pharynx is a common passage for food and air. And pharynx, anatomically, is divided into three parts. It's a nasopharynx, oropharynx, and laryngopharynx. The wall of the pharynx itself four layers. It's here, mucosa, next one, submucosa, muscularis externa, and adventitia. Mucosa, in different places, mucosa is covered by different type of epithelium. In the nasopharynx, it's a pseudostratified ciliated, which is a respiratory epithelium. In the oropharynx and laryngopharynx, it's a stratified squamous, non-keratinized epithelium. And lamina propria, it's composed by loose connective tissue. And muscularis externa absent. Muscularis externa, incorrect. Muscularis mucosa absent. Muscularis mucosa here absent. Submucosa. Submucosa consists accumulation of lymphoid follicles, aggregation of lymphoid follicles with get special names. There are tonsils. If you remember about present of lymphoepithelial ring of Pirogov and Valdeir. Pirogov and Valdeir are two famous scientists who described a lot of years ago this accumulation of lymphatic follicles, aggregation and lymphatic follicles in the pharynx. And main function is the immunity. These are like peripheral organs of the immune response. And we have six tonsils. Pairs and pairs, the pharyngea, tubaria, palatina, and lingualis. So the aggregation of follicles take place in the submucosa. Muscularis externa consists of the skeletal muscle tissue, and the outer layer is the adventitia. The next part of the digestive tube is the esophagus. Anatomically, it's an endoscopic view of the esophagus. In transection, it has the light shape because mucosa together with submucosa make longitudinal folds. Here you can see the light shape. And mucosa, anatomically, esophagus can be divided into three parts. It's very important. It's the apia or first sort, second sort, and the third sort. Let's start from the mucosa. Mucosa in the superior and middle sort, covered by stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. In the muscularis mucosa present, and the submucosa present, so that mucosa make longitudinal folds. And the muscularis externa composed by in this first sort by skeletal muscle tissue, in second or middle sort we have mix present both type of muscle tissue, skeletal and the smooth muscle tissue. In the lower sort, outer layer of the superior and middle sort, it's a adventitia. Let's go to the lower sort or third sort. Epithelium healthy have change of epithelium from the stratified squamous non-keratinized to the simple columnal epithelium in the lower part. It's very important place. And here we have change of muscular excuse me muscularis externa in the lower part, made up of skeletal muscle tissue clear, and outer layer it's a serosa. Let's go to the next organ. Next organ is a stomach. Stomach anatomically can be divided to some parts. It's a cardiac part, fundic part, body, and pyloric part. But histologically, we divide them to three parts because fundic and cardiac part have similar structure and similar type of cells. It's a tubular organ. It's a dilation portion of the digestive tube. It has three or four layers, if we mean submucosa as the isolated layer of the wall: the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis externa, and serosa. And element of relief. Because of presence of submucosa, we have the element of relief of the mucosa. Longitudinal folds, not longitudinally longitudinal, different directional folds. Longitudinal present only in this upper part, which is named curvature, major, lesser curvature, and major. So curvatura ventriculi minor and major in Latin. Only in this region we have two or three longitudinal folds. In other places, they are different direction. They are folds of different directions. And next element of relief, gastric pits, and the last one, mammillated areas. And gastric pits is like evagination of epithelium into the lamina propria. And they have other name, gastric glands. And the mammillated areas, it's irregular areas formed by in places of location of secretory portions of glands in the lamina propria. The small areas in the epithelium of mucosa of the stomach. And what about type of epithelium? Type of epithelium, it's a simple columnal and glandular epithelium. It's called glandular epithelium because of presence of glands, different type of glands. It depends on the region of location. We have cardiac glands. It's fundic or glands or gastric glands in the body and fundic part of the stomach, and pyloric glands. And they made up of different type of cells. And let's start from main glands, which are gastric or fundic glands. We call the main glands because they produce main component of the gastric juice. It's mucus. Let's start from mucus. Mucus neck cells. For it, mucous neck cells are located in the neck region and secrete mucus. Mucus secrete. So these cells mucus secrete. Why we need it? Mucus secretes for lubrication of surface of the epithelium. It's prevent the meeting of surface of epithelium of the mucosa of stomach by aggressive environment of the stomach juice. Because in different places of the stomach we have a different pH. It can be since 1 till 4 and 5, but 1 it's so aggressive, that it can dedimate surface of the epithelium, and the location of mucus secrete on the apical surfaces of epithelium prevents the medium. Yes, so it's a function of mucous next cells. They produce secrete, so that the cells have greatly developed smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So they mostly in slide with staining with hematoxylin and eosin, they are pink color, light pink color of the cytoplasm or colorless cells, mucous next cells. Yes. Next type, parietal or oxyntric cells. Oxyntric cells. They found predominantly in the upper part of the glands. They produce HCl. HCl make acid environment of the gastric juice, and the main function is activate main component of the gastric juice, which is the pepsinogen. It's under the acid environment, under the influence of the HCl, pepsinogen became pepsin. And the cells which produce pepsinogen, there are T cells, and they are located mainly near the base of glands, and try to HCl, they control trinic factor, yeah. Chief cells. These cells are basic staining cells. Why? Because logically, if they produce pepsinogen, it's the inactive, passive kind of the pepsin. It's a protein, so that the cells have greatly development rough endoplasmic reticulum. In the slide with the staining with hematoxylin and eosin, the cell must be blue, dark blue color or basic staining cells, chief cells here in the basic part of the glands. So invagination, low deep invagination, there are glands. And here, chief cells. So chief cells cannot produce active enzyme because this active enzyme can break cell. So they produce inactive enzyme, and in the space of glands, under the influence of the HCl, pepsinogen became pepsin. Next, the enteroendocrine cell. Enteroendocrine cells mostly produce gastrin with stimuli production of HCl, so they influence on the chief parietal cells and stimulate them for production HCl. Glucagon and the serotonin substance PP, so they enter on the cranial cells, stimulate neighboring cells and produce some type of hormones. Pay attention that enteroendocrine cells always have basic location. Very close, try to locate it close to the basement membrane. Anywhere very close to basement membrane to here. And they release, because they release hormones through the basic part of the cell, through the basement membrane into blood vessels, which are located in the lamina propria, and it is the underlying tissue for epithelium. Enteroendocrine cells, they are apoptotic system cells. And the next type of cell, undifferentiated cells, V-type or basal cells. They have similar structure for other type of cells, so the simple columnar, like all of type of cells of the simple columnal epithelium. So the tall cells with large nucleus and light basic staining cytoplasm, but they are young cells. The these cells, the main function of these cells, it's a differentiation into all of type of cells of the epithelium of mucosa except endocrine cells. Only endocrine, enteroendocrine cells cannot be regenerated from young cells or undifferentiated cells because they have other embryonic source of origin. All of type of epithelial cells of the stomach origin from the endoderm.